another edition of Viper's Voices, presented by Murphy Batista LLP. Very pleased to be joined by, a man who really doesn't need much of an introduction, but we'll give him one anyway. Rob Short joins us. Rob, thanks for doing this.
Thanks for having me.
It's a lot of fun to be able to connect with Viper alumni, and we use this platform to be able to do that. I know that you've seen a couple of these from guys that were on teams of yours as well. What do you like about sort of watching the way that they interpret these memories and are able to go back in their mind's eye and remember it almost as if it was yesterday, that some of these great things that happened while you were playing for the Vipers?
Yeah, well, we were a pretty close-knit group, so, those years that we had, and we had a lot of guys that stuck around for long periods of time because we were so close-knit, and they were good times. Like, it's something that I know all the guys take with them, and, you know, the guys have gone all over the world. Everybody's pretty spread out now, so it does get around.
It's a pretty crazy thing to think about. We're going to talk about Vernon Minor Hockey a little bit because we've had, you know, Jagger Williamson on, who was a local guy. We've had Colton Sparrow, who is a local guy. I mean, for you, it's a pretty special thing to be able to be a hometown kid and play in front of your hometown fans and wear that logo on your chest. We'll talk about it in full detail, but I mean, as you sort of look back on it, can you believe it was something that you had the opportunity to do? It seems like something that a lot of kids dream about, but it's not always something that comes to fruition.
Yeah, it was real special. I mean, I can remember when they won back in 99, and they actually brought the RBC Cup to my elementary school. And I remember everybody grabbing it and touching it and taking pictures of it and stuff. And I refused because of the old superstition that if you want to win it, you don't touch it. Right. But, yeah, growing up, I mean, I always went to the games, and it's, like you said, it's not really something that you think is always within grasp, and then all of a sudden you're kind of at that age, and the ball just kind of starts rolling.
Let's talk about minor hockey a little bit. I know I've got a son growing up in minor hockey in the North Okanagan, so not in the Vernon system, but lots of great hockey players have come from this system, you know, guys that have made good college careers for themselves, you know, minor pros all the way up. What was it like playing for you? I mean, you're an 89. So what was the age group like for you as you sort of grew and developed through the minor hockey system here in Vernon?
Well, I actually only played for Vernon minor hockey the 1 year. Would have been my first year Bantam, I believe it was. Other than that, I played for Lumbee. So it was, we had nine guys. It was slim pickings, but again, it was a good team. We had really good coaches. And actually the coach that I had growing up would have been the coach for a lot of the guys that come up with me and after me, and Dave and Kokoski and those guys. So good coaching definitely attributed.
You said nine guys, so obviously that means lots of ice time and lots of time to develop. I mean, it's a bit of an understated thing being – able to play minor hockey in a small community where there's fewer players, which can be a detriment, but in some cases when you're getting a lot of reps and a lot of looks, especially in your young development age, it clearly turns out to be a bit of a benefit.
Yeah, definitely. I think the king of all is ice time, and that goes for practice too. You know, when you do have good coaches and you're out there and there's only a handful of you, you get kind of more one-on-one time with a coach and more repetitions, and it makes a big difference in the long run. And especially for me back when I was growing up, I mean, you didn't play year round. You played in the winter, and when your hockey season was over, it was done. I didn't put my skates on again until training camp the next year. So I know that's not really the way it is today anymore. Guys go year round, which you obviously see as all the younger guys come up, and there's a lot of guys with amazing skill.
What did you do in the off season then? Obviously you got to stay active somehow. You know, a lot of guys, you know, you hear the rumors that lacrosse is a great sport to play in the summer. It really helps you with your hands and conditioning. Obviously soccer is great for conditioning as well. What did you do in the off season to sort of keep yourself in shape for when hockey season was ready to roll around?
Yeah, I always played lacrosse. I played lacrosse for Vernon, and then I played my junior lacrosse for Vernon as well. Then I played football, played rugby when I got into high school a little bit, I played sports all year round, but yeah, as soon as hockey season ended, I didn't even think about it anymore.
What point did you think hockey was going to be something that you're going to excel at? Obviously, you know, playing as many sports as you did, there's probably opportunities aplenty. You know, maybe hockey goes to the back burner on some. Obviously, hockey was one that you focused on, but was there a certain age you can remember where you thought, you know what, this is the best route for me. This is the game that I want to play extremely competitively.
Not really. I think they never really overlapped growing up, so I never had to worry about it. And then in hockey, I mean, the hockey was always my favorite sport, but progression wise, the hockey teams scout a lot more and they contact guys when they're younger and you know, they've got all sorts of programs that really the lacrosse does not have. And so that just kind of gets going earlier, and it kind of gets you on that path before you even really get a chance to think about it. And then it's kind of your decision to keep going down the path or to get off. And there was no way I was going to get off.
What was it like for you? I mean, as you go through minor hockey and you get a little bit older, as you said, you start to get recognized a little bit more. And, you know, I always love asking about the fork in the road, specifically for 14 and 15 year old kids, specifically at the age of bantam, where you've got two leagues that are probably keeping an eye on you in some form or fashion have watched you. And then the decision comes down to, do you want to play in the Western Hockey League and make a run at it that way? Or do you want to play in the junior A circuit? And the decisions that come with it, not everybody knows the ramifications. If you play one game, you can't have NCAA eligibility. What was the process like for you? Were you fully aware of some of the things that you had to go through and the things you had to be aware of moving forward?
Well, I played in Sicamous Junior B when I was 15, 16, my 15, 16-year-old year. And from there, I was picked up by Chilliwack when they entered the WHL. So I was picked up in their expansion draft. And I went down all summer down there and was with them and did all their promotional stuff and through training camp. And I was fully prepared to play for them. And kind of like what you said, it got to right after training camp and they wanted me to sign the contract. And I'd asked them what happens to my eligibility and they really couldn't give me a straight answer. And I didn't know everything of how that worked, but I knew that there was catches and they did try to trick guys into it. And our coach there that year was a coach from the BCHL. And yeah, he really wouldn't give me a straight answer. So I asked him to let me think about it. And I walked out of the room and I called Troy Mick and said, hey, do you have a spot for me? And he said, come on back. And so I left that night.
That's a pretty crazy thing because I guess it goes back to who you trust, you know, to help you, because at the end of the day, they're trying to obviously solidify their roster, but that's a big decision that, you know, sometimes I don't think gets enough focus where, you know, once you do that, you're essentially done. What a great decision. That's a risky play. Obviously, it worked out for you. Did you talk to your family at all about those decisions? And who's your support system as well as Troy?
Yeah, I talked to my dad about it. And he's always very into following everything everywhere in the sports world. And we kind of had a feeling that something like that was going to come up. And he was kind of on me to begin with, saying, you know, going there as an expansion team, you're going to be in for a couple of rough years. It's not going to be the best time you have. And, you know, does it come down to, do you want to go there and struggle, or do you want to play for your hometown team and win and play with guys that you grew up with and know, right? So it made it quite easy to make that decision.
In 05-06, you know, I've done the numbers a little bit. You mentioned that you played Junior B in Sicamous, and now I've finally been in that building. That's a small rink. It's cold. It's pretty intense, but some good hockey gets played there, and a lot of really good players have come through there at different times. But you did AP with the Vipers that year in seven games. Was that always the goal, show your skills in Junior B, and then try to get the opportunity whenever you can? Or is that the year as well that you went to Chilliwack following that season to see what you were going to do? And how did you enjoy those seven games that you got during that 05-06 year?
Well, I was in the Vipers camp that year the year before I played in Sycamore, and Troy sent me to play in Sycamore just for ice time and to get in the games more. So yeah, it was always my goal to work my way up to Vernon, and I never really thought that I would be picked up by Chilliwack, and you know, I was, and they were pretty after me. So, you know, when you're that young, the spotlight of the WHL seems quite bright and you want to go. And, but like I said, I did have my trepidations on it. And luckily for me, I got out of there when I could.
I mean, that whole season with the seven games, what do you remember? I mean, it's quite the jump to go from Junior B to, Junior A, no question about it. But you got into seven games. Do you remember a moment where you went, holy cow, this is a little bit more intense than what I'm used to? Was it the speed? Was it the skill? What do you remember about finally pulling the jersey over for the first time, even if it was sort of in an AP role?
My first game was against Chilliwack in Vernon. And I bet you I played maybe two shifts. And one of them was me just going out and fighting somebody. So, you know, leading up to it, I knew all the guys from camp. I had practiced with them a bit when I was 15. So I did know half the guys. So that makes it quite a bit easier going in and seeing familiar faces. But yeah, I didn't get in much, but even just sitting on the bench and, you know, after growing up, sitting on the other side of the glass your whole life is pretty exciting.
And then you get to, I imagine, get a couple of those games in at Cal Tire Place or the Multiplex, as it was probably known back then. Do you remember taking the ice for the first time, you know, at home? Because it's one of those buildings that, you know, anybody that you talk to still around the BC Hockey League, and there's some nice buildings in the BC Hockey League right now. Cal Tire, the Multiplex, still gets recognized as one of the best in the league. What was that moment like for you when you got to take the ice and you had all the fans here? And I would imagine a ton of friends and family and people you already knew were a part of that.
Yeah, it was awesome. It was, like you say, it's something that you build up to and think about all the time. And you skate out there. And at that point, I would play lacrosse out there and everything like that. And when you come out there and it's full of the fans and you get all the Aussies in the corner making all the noise, it can be pretty exciting.
One of the things that we go through, and this is interesting to note, you know, your first full year in Vernon in 06-07, I'm sure you knew you were going to come back, and you'd sort of AP'd and done the Junior B thing, and you come back 83 penalty minutes, which is quite a bit higher than the rest of your numbers throughout the remainder of your junior career. Did you have a different role when you came into the team? Was it something that you wanted to do to maybe establish yourself, I believe, as a – you know, 17-year-old, 18-year-old, to sort of set the tone? Because as the years go on, it progressively gets lower and lower. Was that something that you took on by yourself, or was that something that you kind of felt you had to do just to get in there?
No, that's just kind of how I've always played. I'd say a big part of it is probably me just getting better at it throughout the years and knowing when not to get caught. Getting away with a bit more than probably what I should have, but it's kind of how I always played. I always look to fill a needed role, and coming in as, you know, at the time 17 years old, I wasn't a small guy. I'm 6 foot and 220 pounds at the time, so you should be throwing your weight around at that point in time.
I'm going to put you on the spot a little bit. I've done this with some guys before, and I'm very interested to see how people's memories continue to prove true. So you would score your first BCHL goal in 06-07. Do you remember the goal, where it was, and who set you up? I have all this information, so I'll give you subtle nods or shakes if you can try track it down. It's always fun to go back that far.
I want to say it was maybe in Trail. Yeah, I think that's probably the game that I had the Jones twins on my line.
Did.
I remember that game.
Yeah, 8:22 into the second period, the lone assist went to Connor on your first goal. What do you remember about that? I mean, it's fun to play in trail first and foremost. And for those guys, they're Kootenai guys anyway. So to have Connor set you up, I mean, do you remember that goal pretty vividly?
I don't remember the goal so much. I kind of can see snippets of the game. I more so just kind of remember the lead up before the game and the coach taking us aside and kind of talking to us and telling us that as long as we didn't get scored on, we'd win the game. And I think we didn't get scored on, and we scored a couple goals, and I think we lost.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he tricked us. But I do remember him taking all three of us out and sitting us down on the bench and telling us that. And that's probably the most vivid memory of it because, you know, if the Jones friends, they come in and they're tiny. They're tiny now. They're tiny back then.
They just for memory's sake, you had a goal and two assists that night. Connor had a goal and two assists. Kellen ended up with one, and you lost 7-5. So, I mean, coaching speeches will, I guess, only take you so far. But it had to be a pretty fun thing all the way around to play with those guys and get an opportunity. That year, you'd finished with 5 goals, 12 assists, 17 points, and the team was really good. 37 wins, which is a pretty impressive feat. You know, a lot of people these days get pretty excited for 30 win seasons in a 58 game schedule. You know, what sort of stood out in that 17-year-old year for you and being on a team that was as good as this one was?
The same thing Vernon always has is just depth and depth of character. Every guy that they have had on their teams that I played for always knew what they had to do every game. They had no problem stepping into any role that was needed during a game. And, you know, it was always that mentality that the other team had to beat us. And, you know, it was our game and they had to kind of take it from us. So I'd say just the character and thought process of the team, and it's carried through getting onto the decades now.
Well, I mean, it's a crazy thing too. Looking through the team as a rule, there were a lot of guys that put up a lot of points. There wasn't necessarily one guy or two guys that went far and away. I mean, Coburn and Ulrich had 77 points, and that was far and away. But you guys had a ton of leaders on this one. You know, Hunter Bishop was there for about 24 games. You had Chris Crowell in the lineup as well. You were there. I mean, that's a pretty – and I'm sure there's guys that I don't know enough that everybody else remembers as a part of that group. I mean, as a 17-year-old, learning from some of these guys, it had to be a pretty easy thing to do to sponge up some of the ways it took to be a junior hockey player.
Yeah, well, we had – like I said, every guy on that team was an absolute workhorse. And they didn't need outside motivation. Every guy was motivated himself to do the best he could, and that rubs off on a young guy. It makes it easy when you can just put your head down and you know that your guys are going to do what they have to, and all you got to do is put your head down and go as hard as you can, and it makes it easy. And those guys were also, we had a good spread of guys with different talents and skills that were willing to teach younger guys and take guys aside and show them the way they do things, and it makes it easy to carry that over.
You guys had a heck of a playoff run. Looking through it, I mean, you would end up suiting up for 20 games in the postseason. And, you know, again, foreshadowing, and I'd love to talk about this a little bit later on, you're the guy who's played the most games, period, playoff or regular season in a Viper uniform. I don't have the number off the top of my head, but I know it's a record that I don't think will be broken because of the streaks that you went in on. But you played 53 games in the regular season. You played almost half that in the postseason. What do you remember about your first installment? You guys would go to the league final, and we've talked with guys who were on that team. Crowell, Hunter Bishop talked about this as well, losing in the league final. I mean, as a 17-year-old, that's got to be a pretty eye-opening experience to see what playoff hockey is all about. How valuable was that 20-game stretch for you?
Yeah, it was a grind. I mean, it's a totally new hockey season at that point. You know, looking back, I played for 5 years, but it feels kind of like you played for 10. You know what I mean? Like we put in a lot of games, but it was fun. I mean, it's one of those things where you kind of forget everything else that's going on in your life at the time, and you're just kind of with the guys always at the rink, trying to stay hydrated and stay awake, and a lot of bus trips. But it's what the guys love, right? We want to play hockey, and that's the best hockey there is playoff hockey.
Well, I mean, you go 6 games with West Kelowna, 5 games with Trail, 5 games with Penticton. So conceivably, it could have been a lot longer with the way the best of sevens worked out. You defeat the V's in 5 games. How exciting was it to win an interior championship? Because, again, you play those teams so much more than the out-of-divisional opponents. It almost feels like winning the interior is, you know, one of the greatest steps that you could do, and to beat the V's in the way you did. What do you remember sort of about the way you guys were able to get through them and represent the interior in the league final?
Well, it's always one of my favorite things to do was to beat the V's. One of the best things about playing with the Vipers is you get that kind of close proximity to some of these interior teams, and it creates quite the rivalries. But Penticton was always fun back then because they had the old Memorial Rink that was tiny, and they had big teams, and those were rough games, and the fans were right on top of you, and they were never big fans of us, and they let us know it, and it really kind of got fired up. So those were probably the funnest games, I think, other than the one that we played in our Civic. Playing in that rink was probably the funnest.
You get to the league final, and you know, again, we talked with Hunter Bishop and Chris Kral about this, and you get the Nanaimo Clippers in the league final. So that's a long travel set. You end up losing in 6 games. But as a 17-year-old, did you put much stock in the fact that you were in the league final? It's not an easy thing to do. Lots of guys never get to one of them, let alone the couple you would get to. But as a 17-year-old, did it sort of sink in what it meant? Or, you know, at the time, was it just another game against the team that you didn't see very often?
Yeah, you'd think about it kind of in between games. Once you're out in the games, you'd kind of go off to the side, and you kind of forget about it. But yeah, it was you know, in the back of your mind, everybody always tells you it's hard to get there, and you're not gonna, you know, you're not necessarily gonna make it back every year, and you think about that, but at that age, you don't really know, right? And like you said, I got lucky; we did make it back a couple times. But we always wanted to win. I think just the way our team was, we didn't really think so much about how big the game was. It didn't really matter to us. We just always wanted to win it. And every night we kind of went out with that mentality. And once you kind of get rolling like that, you stop to really worry about the significance of the game so much and just trust in the systems and the guys.
So that one sort of comes to a conclusion. Coaching change, I believe, happens in the off season, and Mark Ferner takes over, and you guys have another really good season. You won 36 the year, or 37 the year before. You end up winning 36. Your role, I imagine, as an 18-year-old, quite a bit different. And again, you've got, you know, most of the same crew with you as well. How nice was it to come back in to a season with a lot of returning players and try to build upon what you guys were able to do before?
Yeah, well, it makes it easy to kind of keep that momentum going. I mean, we were lucky to keep the same amount of guys going for quite a while. Like my whole time in Vernon, we didn't really have much for turnover. And it makes it easy. Every year the guys get a little bit closer and a little bit better at what they're doing and learning other things, and every year just keeps getting better and better. So it did make it easy. I hope it made it easier for Ferner coming in and being able to just tell us what he wanted, and we kind of all got on the same page right away.
That year was, again, a little bit different. I mean, hard to believe a team that won 36 games finishes fourth in the division. I mean, that doesn't happen very often. It must have been a pretty stacked deck in the interior division. You guys knock off the Trail Smokies just in the first round. You get the V's again, always a good time. This time, though, it didn't work out in your favor. 7-game series loss in the semifinals. A lot of people, they remember the wins, and they remember it for a lot of other reasons, but a lot of times they'll really focus in on certain losses. Does the 7-game loss to Penticton, you know, register at all? And if it did, how did it sort of help set the team up for success, which we know you guys would go on to the next couple of seasons?
I think it was just so much more personal, I think, for a lot of us that time. Like I said, Penticton was such a rival, and we had been up to that point beating each other up so often, and we had been kind of on the top side of those bouts that once you kind of lose it, it really kind of digs deep. And, you know, there was no love lost between us for sure. So I think just the frustration in it, like it was one that obviously we've won those games in the past and we felt like we deserved. And, you know, but granted, they deserved it too. They were amazing teams when we were playing them. But I think it's just one of those things that it gets in the back of your head and you don't want to lose, and you definitely don't want to lose to those guys. And so it really, I think, motivated the guys. We didn't want to go through that again.
And, well, I mean, let's talk about your role a little bit too. I mean, pretty consistent point producer in your 17-year-old year. You had 17 points. That 18-year-old year, 33 points in 58 games and 15 goals, which is nice, and five of those ones come out of the power play. As you sort of continue to grow and develop within the system, did you see your game change at all? Were you sort of given a different role, specifically headed into your 19-year-old year, and we would know how important that was to the entire city and that franchise? You know, maybe speak to your role and how you sort of grew and developed and were able to take on a little bit more of you know, a leadership role as things went on.
Yeah, I think, you know, as you said, as I started getting older there, our team really started to round out as a whole. And it started to be where we didn't have a top two lines, but we had a top four lines. And we were just kind of rolling guys. And it makes it quite a bit easier when it's like that, because it opens up the ice a lot. I mean, the other team gets really worn down when they're trying to play two lines against four. And just me getting better and bigger and stronger and that ice opening up a bit more, getting more ice time and more opportunities like that definitely contributed. But I don't think my role ever really changed. I was always kind of the energy guy that I just made sure I got pucks in and pucks out of our zone and didn't really try to do anything fancy. I was just kind of fast and had an okay shot and just kept going.
That year too, in 08-09, I mean, it's a special year for a lot of different reasons. You know, it had been about a decade since the team's last national championship team. And I mean, you win 42 games out of 60, which is really good. You have, you know, you score a lot. You don't give up a whole lot. You know, sitting atop the division. At what point as that season was going on, did you think, you know, that it's kind of national championship or bust with the group that you had?
We fought it pretty early on. I mean, again, we had such a carryover of guys. We kept basically the whole core of our team through those years. And we knew we were close every year and we were getting better every year. So it was always in the back of our mind, and it was always obviously the end goal was to play right to the bitter end. So I think, God, I'm pretty sure somebody said it in training camp. I'm pretty sure Ferner had said it to us at one point and early on in the year that we were going to win, and that's what he expected from us.
No pressure going forward there. Well, you know, you sort of run through the regular season relatively easily. You get the Bs again, third year in a row, you get a chance. And this time you get them in the semifinals. So early after the 7-game loss the year before, I mean, walk us through that mindset. You said you didn't like to lose, and you sure didn't like to lose to them. And you were able to bounce back nicely in a 5-game series. It seems like the series would have been tighter in terms of wins and losses, but walk us through what you remember about that series and the team able to come away with that 5-game win.
Yeah, they were, God, I don't remember what the stats were that year, but I know they were right behind us. They were really the only team that year that could give us a really honest challenge. It was always up in the air when we played them. I think they broke our winning streak that year. We had gone on like an 18 or 19 game winning streak, but that's I think the year that they would have had their new rink too. So they were a good team, but we definitely, by then, we didn't have so many kinks. We kind of, everybody knew what they were doing and what our systems were, and everybody had bought into Ferner's game plans. by then really good, and we were just kind of a well-oiled machine at that point. We didn't vary too much in our games. It was really hard to shake us. And we just kind of could get teams down into their end and cycle them to death. And I think that's what we did. I think we just kind of outlasted them in that series.
And then you get Salmon Arm, always fun. And the Salmon Arm one, I think, is a lot of fun for different reasons. You talked about proximity and how many times you see a team. I mean, being less than an hour away, when you've got roving fan support, you'd imagine you get fans from both sides in there, and you get them for another chance at a really good interior final. And how great is it to get a chance to play the Silverbacks, and you guys are able to come out on the right end of it. But do you remember about how exciting that series was, just simply because, A, there's not very much travel, which would prove important later. But, you know, again, they were a very good team, and you knew that there was a heck of a rivalry between the two towns.
Yeah, well, when I first started APing and playing for Vernon, Salmon Arm was really kind of the go-to rival at the time. Those were the real battles. And I think over the years, the first couple of years of my career there, we kind of switched over to Penticton. So it was fun to kind of renew that, you know, and for a couple of years there, our big hurdle was to get past Penticton. And then once you get past them, you kind of go like, okay, well, now the Silverbacks are back. So it was fun. And like you said, with it being so close, and then me playing in Sycamore, I knew a lot of people from Salmon Arm and a lot of the guys that were playing on the team. So it was definitely a fun series.
You guys get Powell River the next round. And again, I kind of make a joke about it, because for those who have never done the trip before, I don't think they fully understand the length it takes and the hardship it takes to actually get to Powell River from anywhere. You know, the two ferries, the extraordinarily long bus rides, the winding road on that trip in between, and you know, you get Powell River in the league final. You want to win that league final without question, but how in the heck did you guys stay so focused, because your off days were essentially travel days, and you know, there wasn't a whole lot of downtime in a 6-game series you guys would eventually win?
Yeah, well, I think we can attribute that to us being young back then. I don't think I could do that anymore, but definitely the travel between them was grinding. It was terrible, but at the same time, by then it's starting to get kind of nice down in the lower mainland there, and the weather was all right. But those were long bus rides, and all credit goes to Duncan. He did everything he could to ease all of our travel and make it easy for us to just focus on playing hockey. And you know, but by that time in the year, you're pretty used to sitting on the bus and sleeping in some sort of awkward position, be it on the floor or across a couple of seats. And you just kind of try to do that. You try to get your sleep in, and we'd get out at the ferries and play some kickball or something like that. Or every now and again, we'd run some races just to keep us kind of loose. And other than that, just focus on the games.
Well, let's talk about game 6 of the league final. For you, again, it's extremely important. It's your hometown guy. You got a chance to hoist the Fred Page Cup in your own building for the first time in about a decade. And you guys have it in front of, you know, I'm just waiting to see if I can track the attendance numbers here, but a pretty large crowd, if not a full sellout for game 6. And you don't want to have to go back to Powell River for game 7. What's the mindset? That's a close hockey game. It ends up finishing 2-1. I mean, what do you remember about that? And then when the final horn goes, knowing that, you know, sweet relief, you didn't have to get back on that bus the next day.
Yeah, I think the big key there was just us trying to not think about that and just focus more on the games. By then, obviously in the back of your mind, you never want to hop onto a bus for 16 odd hours or however long it did take us to get down there. But I think we just tried to focus on the games. We were pretty strong in our own rink. I don't think we'd lost there much up to that point. And I think a big part of it was just the confidence. We were pretty confident we were going to win, and it was just a matter of getting out there and doing it.
Easy to win games, too, when you're only giving up 16 shots total in a 60-minute hockey game. The numbers that night, you guys outshoot Powell River 11-2 in the first. It's a tight second period. You each get a goal. And then I don't know if this is accurate or not, but 6 shots total in the third period, 3 for you guys, 3 for them, 1 goal hockey game. I mean, assuming these numbers are accurate and they're coming right from the BCHL website, so you like to think they are. I mean, that's about a defensive and nail-biting, grinding style of hockey game. When the final buzzer goes and you win, what's the feeling like? And again, you're doing it at home in front of all of your friends and family. I mean, walk us through whatever emotions that you remember.
Yeah, I think it probably doesn't hurt there either to mention that probably both teams' best players were their goalies. So it does, it's a lot closer than one might think. But I that's just classic playoff hockey. Is you really kind of get into that. Goalies win championships, defensemen win games, right? So we were always, the stats didn't really show it because we did score quite often, but we were always kind of a defensive minded team first. And I think once you got into playoffs and guys really got into that mentality, those games, they grind the other team right down. And they were kind of the same way that year and the next year as well. So that's I think that would be one of the better playoff hockey system-wise that has been played.
And it's tough to watch as a fan, I'm sure, because you have no control over the outcome. You're just sitting there grinding away at those nails. Let's talk about the Doyle Cup. I mean, for you guys, and you talked about it, playing in the Civic wasn't expected, but you get Grand Prairie, and, you know, I get to call one game at the Civic Arena before it was demolished, the last game that anybody ever played in it, and it was a very special, cool thing for a number of reasons, and I'm sure you'd agree. You warm up in front of a sold-out barn because you've only got so many people to get in there. You know, what you would normally get in Cal Tire at 3,500, you're not getting anywhere near that. And now you're in a Doyle Cup championship. What do you remember about taking the ice in a building that, you know, not many people could and a place that housed so much great Viper history?
Well, yeah, and that's like so many of us. We had a fair number of hometown guys at that point, and that's kind of where a lot of us grew up playing. And it's where we all kind of grew up watching the Vipers play. So it was definitely something exciting for us. And then for the other guys that were still around, we were, you know, like I said, our best games were always the ones in that small rink in Penticton. So now we finally got to play in our own small barn. And all the guys were pretty excited about it. And I think one of the funner things was the thought process is always that the Alberta League is more rough and tumble than the BCHL. And we were such a high scoring team that I think everybody kind of thought maybe we were prima donnas and we're going to get just kind of rolled over by this bigger, tougher team. But we had really, really big guys. Like we had some defensemen between Lytle and Kyle Bigos and Chris Crowell on the front end. Cameron Brody on the back end. Like we had men on our blue line, and I think they weren't expecting us to be as rough as what we were, but that was kind of our bread and butter. So it was fun to get into the small rink and bump guys around a bit.
And wasn't that the series where there was absolute chaos? Again, I wasn't there, so I'm taking stories that are shared down from Todd, who was calling the games at the time, and the guys that we've talked to that were part of the team. That series specifically in the Civic was, was hockey even the word at that time? Apparently things got a little heated. What do you remember about the chaos that ensued? And of course it could only happen in the Civic Arena and the few times that you were forced to play there.
Yeah, well, I remember our fans were quite on their goalie. They had I can't remember his name. I want to say his last name was Carver. But he was quite the character, and he really bought into it and was giving it back to the fans. And in that rink, you can hear everything that everybody says. So that gets everybody a little bit fired up. And then they did have one player who came from Penticton and was traded there. And I believe what happened was he had jumped Bryce Kokoski from behind. And then Krause came in, I think, behind him and peeled him off. And then he ended up fighting one of the referees. He ended up kind of throwing around one of the linesmen. So that I think he got kicked right out of Hockey Canada, to be honest with you. But Yeah, it did escalate a little bit.
Well, you guys win the Doyle in four, and you get to make your appearance at the Royal Bank Cup in Victoria. And I didn't know this until you started to chat with a few of the guys that were a part of it. You pretty much had your way with the round robin tournament, but then you end up playing Humboldt in the finals, and you guys lose a couple of 20s like right off the hop in that game. You know, Chris Crowell talks about it, and the name escapes me of the other 20 that got kicked out for those checking from behind.
Ryan Santana.
Yeah, that is a phenomenal thing. You're in the big game, big stage, TSN, chance at the title, and you lose two of your 20s. So what do you remember about the finals?
Yeah, well, it's heartbreaking, especially in the case of Crowell. I played with him up to that point for 5 years, and he was, you know, the heart and soul of the team. So to see him kicked out in that spot when you know that he just wants to play is pretty tough. And, you know, they're pretty tough calls. They didn't give much leniency on those, and they're calls that I'm kind of surprised that they make in that situation. But, you know, at the same time, I think that motivated our team at that point. Once you see Chris Crowell get kicked out and you know that he's hurting, I mean, we weren't going to lose that game.
How fun was it to make the return trip after you win the national championship? Again, it's something not many people get the opportunity to do, and you get to do it in your hometown. You get home, and I'm sure everybody was excited to celebrate. What do you remember about, you know, the emotions and feelings of that?
Yeah, well, it's one of those things where, like I said, most of the time our mentality is always on the next game and just staying focused for that, and then all of a sudden there's no more games to focus on, so it all starts to really kind of set in that we set out to win this, and here we are, and we have, and it's just, it's exciting to come back and see everybody who's always been supporting us. And, you know, for most of us, we have been uplifted by them for the last 4 or 5 years. So it's nice to come back and share that with everybody.
Now you've won one. That's great. What are you going to do to top it? Well, I mean, hard to top a team that won 42 games the year before, but if there was a team to do it, it was going to be this one. 51 wins out of 60. That is an obscene number when you look at it. Only a handful of teams have ever had success like that. You know, the V's would do it a year or two later. You guys back-to-back, you won 93 regular season games in 2 years, which is, again, obscene. Was it the same as the year before where you thought, you know what, it's national championship or bust, and we know that pretty early?
Yeah, well, again, we had so many guys come back again that it was really, for all intents and purposes, kind of the same team. And, you know, we had just been playing just a couple months ago, so we're still kind of in the swing of things. And, yeah, we always, right from the get-go, we knew that anything less than another win would be not worth it. So we were all bought in right off the bat to make that trip again.
We'll run right into the playoff run, because, again, that's where, you know, everybody remembers the regular season. Maybe there's one or two things that stand out, but it's the playoff memories that tend to ring true. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe I've got this story right. You guys play Quinnell in the first round, and you go down 2-0. Is that accurate?
God, I don't even remember.
Maybe I have that correctly, and fans will definitely correct me if I'm wrong on this. I believe it was one of those you went down and then reverse swept. If not, well, I'm wrong, and this show is, you know, we're doing the best we can with what we got. But, you know, it's the playoff matchups against Quinnell, Penticton. I mean, those, you win both of those in six games. Again, it looked like it was a little bit more difficult, though, both rounds to get through. Do you see the competition getting a little bit better when it came to the pressure, which would all be on your side because you were the defending champs and the league champions again in the regular season? How did you see other teams start to play you, specifically Quinnell and Penticton, in those first two rounds?
Our teams were always fired up to kind of see us lose and fall short. And every game we played would be against the other team's best. They're always quite motivated and ready to play us. So it was good for us because it'd keep us on our toes. You know, it's like you said, sometimes with the success that our team had, you would have guys start to kind of let off the gas pedal and stuff like that. But the other teams, they didn't really let us. So they kept us going full bore the whole year.
Second year in a row, you get Powell River. And, I mean, this is a series that will stand the test of time, I think, in Viper lore and for a number of different reasons. We had Graham Gordon on earlier on in during this pandemic. And, obviously, he was a key part at times, and he admits that, you know, sometimes he made things more interesting than they needed to be. Those were his words. But when it mattered the most, he was there for you in the league final with a save that, you know, has stood the test of time. What do you remember about Game 7? I know it goes down to two things, the Sahir Gill goal and that big save by Graham Gordon, sellout crowd, and another championship. Was there anything else within that game? I mean, it has to be a pretty fantastic moment when you're up against Powell River. The rivalry playoff is there, and it's amazing to do that against an out-of-division team. It's not always easy, and you guys are able to win that one 3-1.
Yeah, well, it's that, you know, by then we did have a bit of a rivalry going with Powell River. They definitely wanted to beat us. They had a lot of the same guys back again. I think that year too, we had one of our games get canceled against them because they had a power outage at their rink, I think, and so we'd had to make another trip out there anyways. But yeah, that was I vividly remember Gordo's save. I was right there. That was probably my guy that got that shot off of a weird bounce. So he definitely saved me. But that was an unreal save. That was a true move of athleticism on his part. I still don't fully understand how he got it, but it definitely took the wind out of their sails.
You win the championship again at home. But again, that seems like just a step on the way to the ultimate goal. You get a really game Spruce Grove team, and you're able to knock them off in 7 games. So that one, as opposed to the Doyle from the year before, a heck of a lot tighter. And if you don't win that, obviously you don't get a chance to represent yourselves at the national championship. When you win the Doyle, you know, against a team that you've never played, what were some of the challenges, and obviously how excited were you guys to get the win?
I think that's one that we felt we wanted to kind of win to prove that, you know, it wasn't just luck the year before and wasn't luck that we made it back again. I know they were ranked quite high in the Canada rankings the year before when they and Grand Prairie had upset them. I'm pretty sure it was Grand Prairie that upset them. And then they were ranked right behind us again all year. So I think their mentality was that they were the better team than us, and we didn't really like that idea. So we definitely wanted to prove them wrong.
What was it, easier or more difficult or maybe more nerve-wracking to make your second appearance at a national championship? Obviously different venues, and from Victoria to Dauphin, geographically, there's a significant difference. But did it make it easier having done it before, knowing what you knew from before? Because again, finished second in the round robin, but then you kind of roll through everybody. And then obviously the final game itself was over relatively early in an 8-1 game. Was that whole process easier having done it once before?
Yeah, I think so. You always, you know, up to that point, you don't ever really play in a tournament setting. So that can be kind of stressful, just because if you have one bad bounce or one off game, it could mean the end of the season, right? But we kind of had all gone through that already, and we're pretty confident in that we'd be able to get away with that. I know we were 100% confident that we'd win in a 7-game series, but when you get in those tournament scenarios, you know, it doesn't take much to turn the tide. So I think that year, just with the experience from the year before, we were quite calm, a lot calmer than we were the first year. The first year we figured that we had to win absolutely every game decidedly. And this one we were more comfortable, and we knew that we had a little bit more room and we didn't have to squeeze our stick quite as tight. And so we were quite relaxed, I think, going into that one.
Clearly that result was absolutely true, an 8-1 win and a second national championship. I mean, not a bad way to end a junior career, you know, with a couple of national championship rings, with, you know, guys that you'd grown up and played with and doing so in your hometown. When you put a bow on your junior career, I mean, could you have asked for anything better? It seems pretty storybook.
Yeah, I know it's, I mean, everything you could ever wish for, really. I mean, you know, everybody on that team is such good friends, and to share that with those guys is definitely the highlight of my hockey career. You know, I think looking back and seeing all those guys work through the years and stuff like that, and for us to have that success was just, you know, as good as it gets.
When it came to what you were going to do after junior, you know, obviously you played the junior A circuit. So NCAA tends to be the way a lot of people go. What was that process like for you when it came to what you were going to do after? Was NCAA an option for you? Or, and obviously, as it shows, the year after your last year in junior, you played in the SPHL. So you went pro after. For those who may not know, and for whatever you're comfortable sharing, what was the process like in terms of NCAA options, or what your plans were as junior was winding down?
I talked to some schools and stuff like that, but didn't get really any serious talks in with them. I actually eventually ended up hooking up with a guy from down in Dallas that Jason Williamson had played for, and he got me in contact with him, and he'd actually come up to some of our games. And so I went down for tryout with them in the Central Hockey League, and that was the Texas Brahmas. And from there, I went cross town to the Allen Americans, and I was there for a couple weeks into kind of the early part of the season. And then I got sent down to Pensacola, Florida. And I mean, it's, you go from living up in the Okanagan your whole life to, I had a house down on the Gulf of Mexico. Was quite the change. Not the normal hockey environment I'm used to, but it was exciting. It was fun. It was a bit different to get out of the house and out of the country and so far away.
Well, and then I guess the next 2 years, you know, you went to Louisiana, which is the same sort of thing. And you jump up with the Rio Grande Valley Killer Bees for a couple of games as well. Did you like playing pro? What was it like? Obviously in that league, you know, we know of a couple of guys who have made that jump into pro. Obviously a lot different in terms of lifestyle, but the hockey itself, you know, did you have fun doing it? Was it something that you sort of embraced for the few years you were able to do it?
Oh yeah, no, it was awesome. I mean, I would consider Lafayette, Louisiana to be kind of like my second home. I've got people there that I would consider to be family. We still keep in touch. And it was just such a welcoming place. I mean, to go down there and live that lifestyle is quite eye-opening and quite the experience. And I wouldn't trade it for anything. I mean, it's not something that a lot of people get the opportunity to do. You know, I didn't have anything to worry about but playing hockey down there and just having a good time. So did a lot of sightseeing around the southern states and watched my fair share of football games and went to some tailgates and had a good time.
And life of the guy in the early 20s, in his early 20s, playing a sport he loves in a very beautiful place in the United States. The first time I ever spoke with you was at the national championship that the Vipers were hosting in 13-14. You were doing some scouting work. And when we had you on the broadcast, you alluded to an injury that you suffered in your professional career. Not everybody may be aware of that because, again, keeping track of all the alumni is a little bit different from the organizational standpoint. What can you share or feel comfortable sharing about that and how your the hockey portion of your life sort of came to an end?
Well, I was back in Allen in Dallas at that time in the East Coast Hockey League. And I got traded, my SPHL rights got traded to Peoria, who just dropped down out of the AHL. And so I went there, and it was a bit farther of a drive than I thought it was from Dallas up to basically Chicago. And I got in kind of middle of the night, I want to say 3 a.m. or so, and we were on the ice at 6. I'm sorry, I got in at 6, and we were on the ice at 7, I think it was. And my coach had kind of told me that I didn't need to go out there, but I didn't have anything else to do, so I went out for a skate, and a guy just kind of lost his edge and skated into me. And at the time I thought I just pinched a nerve in my back, kept practicing for a little bit, and then went to see a doctor, and he said I had minor whiplash, and I stayed at home for 2 days. And finally, my girlfriend, now wife, convinced me that I did in fact have to go in and get x-rays. I was pretty adamant that a doctor told me I was just had minor whiplash, and that's what it was. And so yeah, I went in to get x-rays, and my neck was broken. I broke three vertebrae and dislocated it in a couple spots and tore all my muscles. So I was a bit beat up. Had a spinal surgery, and they made it all back up for me, and that was it. That was the end of her.
That's obviously not the way I'm sure you envisioned your hockey career ending. Before the injury, you know, was that something, you know, playing in those leagues, is that something that you had envisioned doing long term? And, you know, from there, knowing that, you know, the hockey career might be in the rear view, what does a guy sort of go through when that happens? The thing that you've done for most of your life all of a sudden is sort of taken away, and not because of anything that you did. You know, what goes through your mind in that, and were you able to get some closure on it?
Yeah, it was definitely unexpected. It's not something I ever thought of, was my hockey career ending like that or at all. But it's just one of those things that you kind of got to take the good with the bad. And I was lucky. It could have been a lot worse. They were very surprised when I came walking into their office like that. So it could have been a lot worse of an injury. And I know the hardest part for me is I've never broken a bone in my life. And so to go and break my whole neck, it seems pretty pretty unexpected. And I'd never really had any serious injuries up to that point. I've taken my fair share of sticks and pucks to the face and the odd skate. But other than that, nothing that had lost me any amount of time. So it wasn't something that I was used to. And up to that point, I would have been 25. That were 24 that year, I think. Up to that point, I had never really stopped. I was always playing a sport at all times, and then all of a sudden I was laid up for a year. I was basically unable to move and in a neck brace, and couldn't do much for that year, and that was pretty hard to take. But then after that, I mean, life keeps going. I moved up to Grand Prairie and started working, and gotta find something to fill the void.
Well, we'll talk about your support system. You mentioned your girlfriend at the time, who's now your wife, was there. I imagine, and there at the time, you know, the support is crucial. You're in a different country. You know, you're not exactly close to home. You know, how important was that support system, whether it came to her or your family or whoever helped you sort of get through that and you know, back on track to the life you're living now?
Well, yeah, it was always you know, it's definitely something that's needed. Up to that point, every year I had traveled down by myself, and then she'd come kind of after Christmas time, just because it's so hard for her to come down for any extended period of time into the States without a work visa. So that was the first year that she drove down with me, and lucky she did, because yeah, it would have been rough. I was in the hospital for quite a long time, so it would have been rough just sitting there by myself.
You mentioned you're in Grand Prairie these days, working. You know, obviously the man you are now is probably still got lots of the man you were before. What is 2020 version of Rob Short up to? Obviously, you're a fan favorite. Actually, you know what? I almost glossed over this, and I didn't mean to. You were the first guy to have your jersey hung at Cal Tire Place. The number 20 hangs in the rafters. When that happened, what did that mean to you? Maybe that's the closure you might have been looking for, to know that the number of games you played, which is the most in franchise history, all the way through regular season, playoffs, tournament games, everything, you have that number, and I don't think it's going to get broken. What did that mean to you to see the number 20 hanging in the rafters?
Well, it means the world. I remember when Duncan came up to me and told me he was wanting to do that, and it's not something that I had ever crossed my mind. I mean, I played with a lot of great players that I could make arguments that their jerseys should all be hanging up before mine. So, you know, and there's decades of success before we ever came along. So it's definitely not something I ever thought would happen for me. I was very surprised when Duncan told me. I don't even remember if I could say anything back to him. I think I probably just stared at him for a couple minutes. No, it was, you know, it's definitely the biggest feather in my cap to have somebody like Duncan Ray decide that I was the guy that he wanted to hang up my jersey. You know, it was quite an impact for me, for sure.
You are a local guy. You get to play your junior hockey, your entire junior career, minus, you know, a little bit with Sycamores, in your hometown. The fans that watch these videos and keep tabs on you throughout your career post junior and love to follow this. Is there anything that you wanted to sort of share in terms of how your time with the Vipers sort of impacted you as a person and the time of your life? Everybody says being a junior hockey player is the best time of your life. And with two national championships and the accolades that the groups that you were with were able to achieve and the things you were able to do subsequently after, what did it mean to you to be a Vernon Viper? And do you have anything you'd like to share with the fans that watch these videos extremely on a regular basis to keep tabs on it?
I think it's one of those things that you don't really think about it at the time that you're playing, but the experiences that you have from all the different guys, especially in Vernon, is kind of a blessed organization. You get a lot of guys from all over the map. I know we played with a lot of East Coast guys and guys from down in California and stuff like that. And once you can rub shoulders with guys like that and see, you know, kind of how they do things and hear stories about other parts of the world and stuff like that, I think it really starts to add up and build a lot of character in young guys. And, you know, that carries over to everything they do. They kind of take that with them everywhere. And once they're done hockey, the hockey's not really done with them. They always have that to lean on. Those guys are always going to be friends for life with them. And it just starts a big network, you know. Even here in Grand Prairie, I mean, there's hundreds of guys that I know through the grapevine somehow that, you know, we're all connected. We've all played against the same guys or played with the same guys or coaches. And, you know, it's just a big, big network of guys.
Rob, we really appreciate getting the chance to connect with you. Thank you so much for sharing the stories, taking the time. Great chatting with you, and I'm sure we'll get to do it again sometime down the road.
Thanks, Grant.